Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to week number 3, our final night of our Let's Talk About Him Family Life and Bible Prophecy Seminar with speaker Pastor Roy Dennis. Now, I'm sure we've been listening night after night. We've been here Sabbath after Sabbath, and we've been enjoying this series thus far. So with that being said, I just invite you to stay tuned. Those who are watching online, remember to share the link with a friend. Those who are in the sanctuary, feel free to invite your neighbor, your co-worker, a family member, a close friend, anyone to come out to church at 13A Caledonia Road this Sabbath for the rest of this series. Before we get into tonight's message on divorce proofing your marriage, let us pray. Most righteous and eternal Father, we want to give you thanks for today, for life, hope, and strength, for wisdom, for knowledge, and for understanding. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we're here to give you praises and adoration, sing praises unto your name, Lord, I pray that you just touch us, Lord. I pray that we'll deliver with true authenticity, Lord. Thank you for everything you've done for us and what you continue to do. Please bless us even now as we go into the rest of the program. In your name I pray, amen. I now invite our praise team for our praise and worship segments.
March.
Behold, he
trumpet calls, lift your voice, is the hero of Jubilee.
no God like Jehovah. There's 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 no God like Jehovah.
Behold, He comes riding on a cloud, shining like the sun, as the trumpet calls. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, He comes riding on a cloud, shining like the sun, and the trumpet calls. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee.
You to just lift up your voice as we sing that song.
Tonight, and I bring you greetings from the Royal Flat District, five churches. But I also bring you greetings on behalf of all the other districts in the parish of Manchester. God is good, they say, and he's really good. All right. But I'm going to invite you to stand at this time. Rest assured, we're praying for you and for the work of the Holy Spirit as we carry the message in this series. Your heads are bowed, eyes closed. Heavenly Father, we draw near to you tonight in the name of Jesus. Thankful that not only did you awaken us this morning, but you carried us through yet another day. And you have brought us here again to hear your word, to lift our hearts in praise and thanksgiving and prayers. And as we pray now, we ask for a double portion of your Holy Spirit here tonight, and especially on your man servant as he brings the word. Saturate this place with your grace. And in the homes of those online, let your spirit move on hearts. And may tonight some soul find peace with you in Jesus Christ. Continue to bless this church in its ministry, the pastors, the leaders, the members. Help that they will always be united in the vision of uplifting Jesus Christ and living lives that exemplify his life. So take full charge tonight, Lord. We commend everything to your care and ask that you'll defeat all the plans of the enemy and let everything work as it should to the honor and glory of your name. And we say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I would like to thank our parish coordinator for treating us with his presence here this evening. We are delighted to have Pastor Champier here with us. Also, Dr. Dudley Hussein from the Jamaica Union will be here with us, and we will hear from him some moments from now. We are delighted to have visitors in our midst. There is someone who is related to Elder Vinton Mullings. If you're related to Elder Vinton Mullings, please stand. Amen. You are on the outside. We have a gift for you and would like you to be on the inside. We will take your gift to you very soon, but we are happy that you're here, and please continue to come. I will tell you, somebody told me today, not from Jamaica, from what we call Big Farin, Sister Forbes, and they told me, I particularly loved the message last evening. I was going through some difficult time, and the man of God spoke into my situation. I am strengthened. I feel blessed, Pastor. I can move on. And we are grateful for the impact of this series across the globe. And if you have a testimony, something that this series has done, perhaps nurtured you in the area of family life or prophecy, or you want to give your hearts to Jesus Christ, please share it with us. We would like to know, and we would like to contact you and pray with you and support you in your decision for Christ. I will say to you also that if you would like to give to this great evangelistic series, please contact us as we guide you in your giving. And as always, I will remind you of things to come. What is happening on Saturday at 4 p.m.? Can someone tell me what is happening at 4 p.m. on Saturday? It is what? Marriage recommitment service. More than 35 couples will recommit themselves to each other and to the Lord. And what is happening on the 21st of April at 7 a.m.? What is happening? We will be having our prayer breakfast, and we are inviting you to be here. And what is happening after the preacher preaches on Sabbath? Something is going to happen. What is going to happen? We are going to have a grand what? A grand baptism. And if you are not yet baptized, you need to speak to us so we can prepare you for this grand occasion. As I take my seat, I will encourage you. You might be online. Perhaps you are on the CJC platform. Perhaps you are on the Mike Town platform. Or you are on the Mandeville SDA Church platform. But you are a visitor, and you have been timid in accepting Christ, or there are distractions in your way in giving the Lord your heart. If you are ready for Jesus, Jesus is ready for you. Give your heart to him and leave all the consequences to Christ Jesus. It is him who called you. And if he calls you, move towards him and leave the consequences to the Lord. I guarantee you, he will take care of the consequences of you giving your heart to Jesus Christ. Thank you, and may God continue to bless you.
Good evening, one and all. So, children's story. Well, no, sorry. The health nugget. The health nugget. And we are looking at neurodivergency. So just waiting for those PowerPoints to come up. We're looking at neurodivergency, beautiful minds, fearfully and wonderfully made. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could look inside our brains to see what God has in there? And so with that, we are going to have a children's story to introduce the nugget today. So we are kids under construction. We are God's children, beautifully and wonderfully made. Keep the PowerPoints moving, please. And so our story is about two frogs who are playing with their friends, Freddy and Frida. Children's story. Frogs who loved to play. And they were flicking flies and floating on lily pads and having fun with their 15 friends. And they were having so much fun that Freddy and Frida fell into a pit, into a big black hole. Somehow they got themselves in that mess. And their 15 friends gathered round and looked deep inside and said, oh boy, initially it was encouragement. He was like, oh, you all right, Freddy? Are you all right, Frida? What happened? How did you get in that mess? And as they continued to jump around in their excitement, they began to say, but boy, it looked bad. It looked bad. How stupid are you to get yourself in that state? How are you going to get out of that? You see, it's because you're rude. It's because you're naughty. You just don't behave. That's why you're in that situation. And with all their excitement, they began to continue to jump and run and flap their hands. And Freddy and Frida at the bottom of the pit, seeing all their excitement, didn't understand what was going on. But Freddy and Frida tried to jump. They tried to jump out of the pit. And Freddy began to get discouraged. And his face began to sink, moving on to the next slide. And he began to give up. But Frida, she just kept pushing. She just kept jumping. And she kept going. She kept going. And her friends were like, oh, no, give up, give up. There's no hope, there's no hope. But Frida continued to jump. And eventually, Freddy, feeling discouraged, gave up. And all hopes were dead. And Freddy just gave up the ghost. Moving on with the slides. But Frida kept going. Frida kept jumping. Give up, her friends kept calling. There's no point. It's useless. But Frida kept going, and with one big effort, out of the pit, she came. And all her friends looked at her and said, Frida, did you not hear us saying, give up? And Frida began to sign language. Next sign. I'm deaf. I can't hear very well. But I can do all things through Christ who give me strength. So I kept trying. I kept pushing. Keep the slides going, please. We are kids under construction, beautifully and wonderfully made. There's nothing that we can't do in Christ Jesus. Keep the slides going, please. Keep the slides going, please. Keep the slides going, please. Okay, for the sake of time, I'm going to move on. Okay, so we are kids under construction. Now, I want to get to the next slide. God made our children special. Do you see our children? They're our babies from Mandeville. Do you recognize them, Wilton? Which one of those children are disabled? Which one is disabled? Which one has challenges? I'd like to suggest to you that we can learn some things from the story. Moving on to the next slide. The power of the tongue to kill or destroy. We can fall down. Our kids can fall down, but encouragement helps them to get up again. Next slide, please. We need to, in our church challenges, as the science behavior, competitivity, it can include sensory overload. What is autism? Some of the symptoms: inattentiveness, easily distracted, unorganized, difficulty listening. Doesn't that sound like our teenagers anyway? Hyperactive, difficulty sitting still. You know, they may be the one who's always, their legs are always twitching, or they're just on the move. They're on the phone and everything all at once. They rush through tasks. They make rash late diagnoses. What happened to those little children when they grew up? Just because they weren't climbing over the chairs anymore, they grew up to be with autism. Now we are realizing we have been misdiagnosing the girls and giving them different mental health labels because they're the quiet one in the class. They're the ones not giving trouble. They present very differently. They may be masking, pretending to be somebody else. They may be withdrawing.
Because to come forward to collect an offering. Let's pray. Holy Father, who art in heaven, we're just thankful for the opportunity to be present in thy courts tonight. We're thankful for this evangelistic series that has been going on. Lord, we're thankful for those who have surrendered their lives as we're here. Help that as we give, we may give wholeheartedly from our heart.
When you're up on the mountain, you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change, and you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, 'cause you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go right, and the God of the good times is still God in the bad times, the God of the day is still God in the night. You talk of faith, talk comes so easy. When life's at its best, trials at the test. But the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. the God of the day is still God in the night.
Amen, friends. Indeed, the God of the day is the God of the night. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has great plans for you. He wants to take you to higher levels. He wants to bless you indeed. He wants to empower you as you face your challenges. This evening, we're praying for you, and we will have a special prayer session, prayer power hour, as we usually have every Wednesday when we have evangelistic series. So we're going to listen to that song. I'm going to ask you to step forward as we unite at the altar. The altar will alter your situation. God is able, capable, and available. So I'm going to ask the praise team to come forward and sing, and we'll ask you to respond tangibly. Come up the altar as we connect with Jesus right now. You have a challenge. You're in a crisis. You want God to do something more for you this evening. You're online. We want you to indicate your prayer requests in the chat. Place it in the chat. God is omniscient. He knows it even before you place it in the chat. He's able. He will do great things for you this evening.
Like a ship without a sail. Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know?
I invite you now to assume an attitude of prayer, and if possible, a posture of prayer, as we connect with our Father in heaven. Almighty Heavenly Father, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of David and Daniel, indeed, we still believe that Daniel's God surely will deliver. So we come before your presence this evening at the altar, online. We come with humility and sincerity. We come with our cares and our burdens. As the songwriter says, days are filled with sorrow and care. Hearts are lonely and drear. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. We know that you're very near, mighty Heavenly Father, through the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. And we even pray right now, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh upon us here at the altar. Spirit of the living God, convince and convict us to connect with you like never before. Because you have said, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abides in the vine, no more can you except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. For without me you can't do anything. And oh God, you have challenged us that if we abide in you and your words abide in us, we shall ask what we will, and it shall be done unto us. So we're asking you this evening to to do great things for us. We have come at the altar here this evening with our pains and our problems, our challenges, and some of us were in a crisis, but we still believe that you're the God of mighty miracles. We still believe that you can turn things around. We still believe that as we gather the altar, you can alter our situation. We still believe that you will manage what is managing us, that you will handle what is handling us. So we pray this evening in the name of Jesus that you'll break down every idol, cast out every foe. We pray this evening that things will be different in our lives as we connect with you. We pray that you will turn things around, that you will take us from the bottom and bring us to the top. We pray that you'll transform our situation, that you will cast away sorrows and give us joy. We pray that you will cast from our minds negative thinking and that you will empower us to be positive, believing that you will do great things for us. We pray that you will cast away sadness and give us happiness, because we know that a merry heart does good like medicine. So we pray this evening that you will touch down in a tangible way and that you will strengthen our faith to believe the impossible, because you have said things that are impossible with men, they're possible with God, and all things are possible to him that believes. So we pray that we'll believe this evening that you will work it out, that you will give us a financial breakthrough. We pray that you will believe that you will heal our sicknesses and that you will empower us to face our sickness, sorrow, and challenges. We pray this evening that we'll believe that you will bring back our children to us as parents, because you have promised in Malachi 4 verse 5 that before that great and dreadful day of the Lord, that you will turn the hearts of the children to the parents and the hearts of the parents to the children. You have promised that you will bring back that wife to that husband. We know that you can change the situations we're facing in our marriages. You can bring back husbands to wife in an intimate relationship. We pray, mighty God, that that wife who is planning to divorce her husband will change her mind and connect with you and her husband. We pray that husband that is planning to beat up his wife, we pray that you will convince and convict him. We pray that you will eliminate abuse out of the family. We pray, mighty God, that you'll bring love and peace in the family. We thank you for what is happening at the Mandeville Church, oh God. We pray that love will prevail in the family, because we know that there's beauty all around when there's love at home. So we pray that we will experience love, because you have said, he that loveth not knoweth not God, because God is love. So we pray tonight, oh mighty God, that as the preacher preaches, that we'll experience love, the love of Jesus, agape love, because that's what we need today. We need love in our hearts, to love unconditionally, to embrace each other, because we see that the devil is making inroads in the families. He's seeking to break up families, but we pray tonight in the name of Jesus that he'll break down every idol, cast out every foe. Mighty God, we pray that the weapon that is formed against the families at the Mandeville Church, those who are online, those who have been viewing, shall prosper. We pray that when the enemy shall come in like a flood, that your spirit shall lift up a standard. Mighty God, tear down the kingdom of the devil, and we pray that you'll bring a revival here at this series. Oh God, we have been pressing on, we have been talking about him, and we pray, oh God, that you'll manifest your presence, manifest your power, do something extraordinary. We are ordinary people, and we know that you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. So we pray tonight that you'll pour out your spirit upon every worshiper, pour out your spirit upon every husband, every wife, every boy, every girl, every child, every parent, and we pray that a revival will break out. And we pray in a mark way that you'll pour out your spirit upon Dr. Roy Dennis. Give him the unction to function, oh God, give him the anointing. And we know that you have placed that on him, but we pray that tonight it will be in full force. Mighty God, have your own sweet way. And we pray that you will lift us up to heavenly places, that we leave your saying, to God be the glory. Great things he has done, that we leave your saying like David, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. And we pray above all things that souls will respond tangibly and pray that prayer, saying, all to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. We pray that they will connect with Jesus and establish that relationship with him, that they can have better relationships in their families. Thank you for being with us, for hearing and answering our prayers, because we ask in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our King. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
pray. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for another wonderful privilege to be in your presence. We're grateful for life. We're grateful for journeying mercies, those of us who are here in the sanctuary, and we're happy for those who are joining online. We're thankful for the preaching of the gospel. Some might consider it to be foolishness, but to those of us who are saved, it is the power of God unto salvation. We're grateful for all those who have already committed themselves to Jesus. And thank you, Lord, there are many more who are still signing up for the Christian Jubilee. So this weekend, we are looking forward to another grand baptism. And even tonight, as the word goes out, we pray that it will go out with power and precision, that men and women, boys and girls, would be brought to the foot of the cross and will come to know Jesus, whom to know is life everlasting. Open your word to our minds and understanding. Use Roy Dennis again as your instrument in the proclamation of your holy word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to Let's Talk About Him. As we focus on the family, we focus on the prophecy, and more so, as we focus on the love of Jesus. Amen. I want to acknowledge the presence of my ministerial colleagues, Dr. Hosin. We have been traveling together for a long time from West Indies College as a part of the Bookman Army, Colporters. He was president of the Colporters Club. I was vice president. So we have been traveling a long time, and we have always supported one another. I appreciate your presence and support and the prayer this evening, Dr. Hosin. We also have Pastor Champier, Pastor Devon Champier, well known in the parish, has been serving this parish for a long time. We're grateful for your presence here this evening. And you know, on Wednesday night, when my wife is always here, either here in person or online, but this is the night that we are able to travel together. Thank you. I have my sister who has been online in Los Angeles on a regular basis, almost every night. And so I want to say hi to Annette. Yes, and when I say sister, this is my sister from my mother's daughter. So hi to Annette over there in Los Angeles, and also my sister in St. James. Appreciate the support of family members. Amen. And we are grateful for those who are online. I looked online earlier on, and initially I saw 200, a little over 200. And then by the time I glanced back on it, it was almost 300. So more and more people are joining, and we are grateful for your presence and your support. This evening, before getting into the topic for this evening, let me share with you some of the topics for next week. Next week, we are moving into fourth gear, and my, how time flies. Fourth gear next week, Sunday night, coping with family violence. Monday night, the fiber factor. Tuesday night, who am I? The crisis of identity. Wednesday night, strong, resilient families. And on next week's Sabbath, the final Sabbath, next week's Sabbath, where's Pastor Shillingford? Pastor Brown is here, Elder Mullings. Next week's Sabbath is the final Sabbath. It's over. So if you have not gotten in yet, and you're not yet baptized, and you have not gotten in on the ship of Zion, it's time to get on board. Amen? Yes. So the final Sabbath is next week's Sabbath, and we'll be looking at journeying together. We are journeying together to the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. So those are the topics that we are looking at for the rest of the time. This coming Sabbath, House of Distress. That's the topic for Sabbath. Tonight, we are focusing on divorce-proofing your marriage. Divorce-proofing your marriage. I sat in my office some years ago, and a man walked in, and he could not wait to sit down. His statement was, "Pastor, tell me how I can get a divorce." To which I responded, "Sir, I am not a divorce lawyer. I am not in the business of putting apart. I am in the business of joining together. And I said that jokingly, but the fact is, I am aware that there are many marriages that are in trouble. Many marriages have been destroyed. Many marriages are being destroyed. And many marriages will be destroyed but for the grace of God. But we thank God that God is still in the business of keeping marriages and families together. What do you say? And I want to say that marriage is still God's plan. Marriage is honorable and the bed is undefiled. What do you say? Marriage is honorable. And so tonight we want to look at what strategies we can put in place to keep our marriages strong, to keep our marriages together. The topic is divorce-proofing from the word weatherproofing. When you think about weatherproofing, you think about putting things in place to protect your house when you have a dramatic weather event. We are in the hurricane belt. And here in the hurricane belt, we have to put things in place to protect us from the hurricane. Now, growing up, we never knew that. Because up to being a teenager, I never saw a hurricane. And my mother would have told us that the last hurricane that she would have seen was the 1951 storm. And after that, no more hurricanes. So in 1988, there was Hurricane Gilbert in Jamaica. Now, we didn't even have a proper radio at home, so I didn't know that there was a hurricane. My sister and I were on our way to school the morning. When we reached the main road that we would have gotten on the minibus, we saw a strange thing, no cars on the road. The minibus was not there at the bus stop. And the bus conductor, those days you'd have a bus conductor, the bus conductor was coming on a bicycle. Where are you going, he asked us. We are going to school. To school? Don't you know that there's a hurricane today? He asked. Hurricane? He said, go home. When we went home, we heard a little wind blowing. We saw the trees swaying. At about 10 o'clock, I took out my pencil and my paper, and I started writing my poem, Come Hurricane Come. Come Hurricane Come. Because I'm saying, if this is the hurricane, then everything will be all right. But by midday, we noticed that the coconut trees were bowing and touching the ground. And we started to get scared. Then after that, we heard the roof flapping on the house, the zinc sheets flapping on the house. And so even the board started to move. And we had a huge rope that we used to tie the cow. And so my brother says, I know how to deal with this. He got the rope and he tied the wood, the lumber, to the one that was tied to the steel on the wall. And he said, this should do it. But when Gilbert got wild, Gilbert tore off everything, lumber, zinc, the whole roof for the three rooms, got up and started flying like a bird. We had to run out of the house, all of us. We got shelter at a neighbor's house, and when we got back the next day, there was no roof. It was nowhere to be found. So if you have found our roof, please let me know. Because we have not found it yet, Pastor Champier. Gone. Gone from 1988. I've been searching for the roof. We have not found it yet. When we got back home, there was a pig in one of the bedrooms. And the pig had eaten out all our food. You know, that's why I don't like pigs. Eat all the food. Since Gilbert, Jamaica has put in some better infrastructure. We have seen some Category 5 hurricanes, and we have fared out better because we have put the system in place for weatherproofing. So it is with our marriages. We need to put some systems in place for divorce-proofing our marriage. Marriage does not come by chance, or as Pastor K.G. Vaz would say, it does not come by spasmodic infusion or osmosis. Marriage is an investment. You have to invest time, you have to invest money, you have to invest communication, you have to invest conflict resolution skills. You have to invest in marriage if you want it to work. So what is marriage? Marriage is a permanent institution. The first place that we see marriage coming up is in the scripture. I have seen where men try to refute some of the records of scripture, where man tried to say that there was no creation, that it was evolution. I've seen where they have tried to refute the flood, but I've never seen anyone try to refute where marriage comes from. The only book that tells me, that I have seen, I don't know if you have seen anything, where the first couple comes from is the Bible. What do you say? Adam and Eve. And God created them. Genesis chapter 2, come with me. We have used that text, but we are going to go back there. Genesis chapter 2, and from verse 18 to 24. This is where the first marriage was performed. And the Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helpmeet for him." And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. And whatever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to the cattle and the fowls of the air and to every beast of the field. And for Adam there was not found a helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman. Made he a woman. And brought her unto the man. And Adam said, "This is now what? Bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And therefore shall a man leave his mother and father and cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." So God created Adam and Eve. Somebody says not Adam and Steve. God created male and female. Male and female. Say male and female. Male and female. That's what the Bible says. God created male and female. This is one of the first gifts that God gave to man after creating them is the gift of marriage. God wants marriage to be a happy place. The marriage between Adam and Eve was an example and to be a pattern of what marriages should be today. Jesus speaks to this in Matthew chapter 19, verses 4 to 6. God wants every home to be a happy home. Matthew chapter 19. And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Have ye not read that he which made them in the beginning made them male and female? And said, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife, and cleave unto his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore, they are no more twain, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder." What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Jesus affirms the principles from Genesis chapter 2 that marriage is between a man and a woman. Number one, that marriage is between a man and a woman. Number two, that marriage produces the deepest level of intimacy that one can find, which we call one fleshness. In marriage, the Bible says you become one flesh. This is the deepest level of intimacy on earth, where the man and woman are united in communication, are united in parenting, are united in finance. But more than anything else, it starts with uniting the husband and wife in a physical, intimate, and spiritual way. One fleshness. In mathematics, 1 + 1 = 2. But in marriage, 1 + 1 = 1. 1 + 1 = 1. Not that you lose your individuality and your personality, but that the two with their similarities and their differences come together to create one happy home. To create one happy home. Two persons, male and female, one more emotional, one physical, one using the right side of the brain more, one using the left side of the brain more, one with bosom precariously perched and well-rounded hips, one with biceps and triceps, one with the sex organ external and one with the sex organ internal. They are made by God for compatibility and complementarity. Male and female, God created them. The third principle from this text, as in Genesis 2, is that marriage is a permanent institution. You don't go into it for experiment, but you go in it because of your commitment. Your commitment. And so, I normally talk about my sister, her daughter is here, Nikayla, that we grow up together. We believed in education. We went to West Indies College together. But when we left West Indies College, we didn't get married. Why? Because God says, I should marry my sister. I should marry my sister. So she found a nice gentleman. Amen. And I found a beautiful lady. And we were planning our wedding for the same day. But we didn't know because she was planning and I was planning. And when she was excited to tell me that she's getting married, I told her, but I am planning to get married too. And it was the same date. And she said, all right, what we could have done is to do a double wedding. But she said, all right, you are the older one. You go the week before and I will go the week after. So she got married and she moved on with her life. And one of the main reasons for this is that the only thing that you don't share in marriage is sexual intimacy. The Bible says that this is the sealing of the marriage contract. It is one fleshness. My sister and I could purchase a house together. My sister and I could purchase a car together. My sister and I could probably adopt children, but the Bible says we must not be together in that way. And so this is what creates the one fleshness. You cannot get closer to another person than to be with them in that intimate way. One fleshness. And when we are doing premarital counseling, and I ask people, what does this mean? And they give me some philosophical answer, I say to them, underline the word flesh. There is one thing that you must not share as a married couple. Amen? That's the only thing that you don't share. And so because of that, Lorraine have to go her way and I have to go my way. The Bible says when you're married, it's one fleshness. When people get married and they get married and they go off to honeymoon on the North Coast, what do they go there to do? To eat hotel food. As a matter of fact, it's not just the Bible that says this. The law of the land recognizes the importance of this. So as a marriage officer, and we have marriage officers here, in my training, you know what the RGD tells us? That if you marry a couple and they are given 1 year for the marriage to be annulled, and the only way it can be annulled is if one of the parties don't have a sex organ.
So if you marry someone and they don't have a sex organ, you can go back to the marriage officer within 1 year, and the marriage officer will bring that report to the RGD and they will annul it. Annulment means that you were never married. Because RGD is saying when you sign the legal document, yes, it is binding. Yes, it will be in their document. But they are saying they are honoring God's law that you need to sign a spiritual one too. And in Old Testament times, every contract was sealed in blood. And so they say, we're giving you 1 year. If you want to take the 1 year and go eat hotel food and enjoy and do everything else and don't find out if the person can sign the contract, that's your business. And in order to sign the contract, you need pen and paper. So if the man have pen and the lady don't have paper, no contract can sign. That's what RGD is saying. And if she have paper and he does not have a pen, no contract can sign. But the RGD is saying, as long as that contract is signed, you are legally, you are married for life. And even if the day after you report that the man beat you up or the woman beat up the man, or you report anything else, it cannot be annulled. It has to be a divorce. A divorce means you were married and now it is coming apart. But annulment means that you were never married. And RGD says, if you don't have a sex organ, you can annul it. You were never married. Bible says you are one flesh, the deepest level of intimacy on earth. And I want you to see the significance, how important marriage is. So all these mothers who are saying, I carried you for 9 months, so the highest relationship is the parent-child relationship. That is not biblical. The highest relationship in the Bible is the husband-wife relationship. That's why Jesus referred to the church as his bride, to show you the high regard that he has placed on his church. So let me take you now through some principles for divorce proofing your marriage. So marriage is an attempt to blend together two distinctly different individuals with different backgrounds and values and personalities, male and female. Divorce is a legal termination of a once promising relationship that has been coming apart socially or emotionally. So we have marriage, and for divorce, it has been coming apart. Divorce don't just happen. The relationship was falling apart. One woman says, when she divorced the first husband, she blamed him. She told her story on one of our radio programs some time ago, how she was married 3 times. And she said when she divorced the first husband, she blamed him. When she divorced the second husband, she blamed him. But when she divorced the third husband, and she looked back, she said if she had changed one little thing, she would have been married to the first husband. Sometimes in divorce, we blame one another. But oftentimes, both of us contribute to the breakdown of the relationship. So, in the United States, and this has changed, 44% of first marriages end up in divorce. 44%. 50 is on the screen, but this has changed recently. More recent statistics says 44% of first marriages in the U.S. end up in divorce. More than 20 million Americans divorce on an annual basis, right? 65% of second marriages. Right? And we see the statistics of divorce over the years from in the 1990s, how divorce rate has been increasing. So we see that in the U.S. that it was, the divorce rate in 1996 was 4.95 per 1,000 people. Barbados was 1.21 per 1,000 people. Trinidad was 0.97 per 1,000 people. And Jamaica was a lower rate, 0.38 per 1,000 people. 1998 coming up, we're looking at Jamaica now. 1998, 1,420 people ended up divorcing. 1999, look at 1999. And I have my theory about 1999. 1,131,
2,000, 1,106. Look at 2001 now. 1,691. Back up. 2002, 1,007. And they start going up from there. 2004. Before I go to the next slide, I have my theory. There are two things I noticed happen in 1999 and 2000 that never happen again. Baptism, and pastors are here, can back me up on that. Baptism were the highest in 1999, in any recent history. Why was baptism so high? In Central Conference, we baptized over 4,000 in 1999. We have never baptized so many. Why was baptism so high in 1999? Anybody can tell me? Jesus is coming in 2000. So everybody who were coming into the church. But the second thing, notice divorce. Divorce in 1999 was one of the lowest in our history. Why was divorce so low? Jesus is coming. So I can't leave my spouse now. So if Jesus was coming and you stay with your spouse, why you don't stay with Jesus not coming again? So look at it now, 2005, Jamaica again. So I'm comparing now, we have the statistics now since 2005 comparing marriages and divorce. So you will see what the picture looked like. In 2005, we had 25,900. So we compare the marriage and divorce and you say what percentage end up in divorce. It's not the same people who married that year divorced, but that's how they do it. Right? So 25,000, what do you see from 2005 to 2010? That marriages are declining. 25,000 down to 23,000, down to 20,000, down to 22,000, down to 21, down to 20,000. And what do you notice about divorce? That divorce is increasing. So the trend in the United States now is that marriages are declining and divorce is declining in the US. So that's not too bad. But in Jamaica now, marriages are declining and divorce is increasing. So you're going to look a little further down now. All right, well, we have these statistics again. These are the most 2017 statistics. 44% of marriages in the U.S. end up in divorce. So you see it move from 50% a decade ago down to 44%. And Jamaica now has doubled from 10% a decade ago to 20% divorce rate. By 2017, I went to Mexico. We had that there, and Turks and Caicos Island. I had put in those. Let me just share something. So in Jamaica, we might say the divorce rate in Jamaica is lower than the U.S. 20%. The U.S. is 44%, but the marriage rate in the U.S. is much higher than in Jamaica. And Statin some time ago gave the report that 66% of Jamaicans never get married as long as they live. So that means only 33% of Jamaicans get married. It does not mean that the other people not doing married people thing. But we have a culture that you just take a woman and call her your wife. But their name has not reached the RGD. And when you are ready, you take that woman, you call her your wife, and when you're not pleased with her, you move on to another woman. And the women are doing the same thing. That you just live together. But the Bible says that marriage is honorable and the bed is undefiled. And even if there are many marriages that are breaking up, marriage is still God's way. Marriage is still God's way. Male and female. Amen. So what are the causes for breakdown in marriage? Marrying for the wrong reason. Marry for financial security. You know that there are some women who marry because they want a security guard. They don't really want a husband. They don't want a partner. They don't want a co-equal. But they are afraid to go in their house at nights by themselves. So what they really want is a security guard. You could pay one. And there are some men who just want a sex partner. They don't want a co-equal.
But marriage, when you get married, married men, your wife is equal to you. So marrying for the wrong reason, experiment rather than commitment, lack of trust and commitment, breakdown in communication. This is the big one. The majority of divorce cases in Jamaica is over issues of communication. And around the world, studies have shown, I've seen studies saying from 65, maybe even up to 75% of marriages that break up in different parts of the world, it's over issues of communication. Lack of intimacy and sexual satisfaction. Is that important in marriage? Yes. And there are still some married people who are dying for a little good touch. Inability to solve conflicts and lack of forgiveness. In Jamaica, reason cited for divorce some time ago, 2004, extramarital affairs, 27%. Family strain, 18%. Emotional and physical abuse, 17%. Midlife crisis, 13%. Addiction, 6%. Workaholism, 6%. Some of you working money for your wife and you won't take your wife out on a date from time to time. You're going to leave with your house, leave with your car, and leave with your money and no wife. Then you come crying to Pastor Dennis, my wife gone. So you need to make the investment not only in finance, but you must make the investment in time and communication. Effects of divorce, emotional shock, anger, loneliness, unhappiness, self-blame, antisocial behavior in children, difficulty moving on, inability to trust another person for another intimate relationship. Listen to me. Divorce and death, the same symptoms people go through when there's a death in the family is the same thing they go through when there's a divorce. We use this acronym DABDA, D-A-B-D-A, for grief when there's a loss of a loved one. Disbelief, anger, bargaining, distress, and then depression, and then acceptance. And you find that the same thing that people go through when they lose a loved one is the same thing they go through when there's a divorce. The only difference is when the loved one die, you bury them. But sometimes when there's a divorce, the relationship die, but they are still in your skin every day. So I would say sometimes it's worse than death. Worse than death. So it's easier to fix it. And some people don't calculate those risks. You know, when persons come to me and they say that they are going to divorce and say, talk with me. Some of the things I ask them is, how about the children? How will this affect the children? Another question I ask is, how will you relate to the asset? Because, you know, the woman might think that if I divorce, I am the one who will get the house. Or the man might think, I am going to get the house. They never discuss this. But when they are going through the divorce, guess who get the house? The lawyer, because the cost to deal with all those expenses, they don't end up getting anything much. So divorce can cause grief, serious grief. So if you can fix it, fix it. And let me tell you, sometimes you allow some little things just to fall apart. Simple thing that you could have solved. You decide that you're not going to forgive him, or you're not going to forgive her, or you're not going to talk to the person first. Sometimes you're angry at each other, separate from each other, and you don't even know why you're angry at each other anymore. Because it's so long. So, we need to rebuild the trust and rebuild the relationship. So what is God's standard? So here are some standards that God has given us. God says you must leave and do what? Cleave. And we could get into that, but that's not what we're dealing. Social relationship. And listen, leave and cleave does not mean you don't take any advice from your parents, but the primary relationship is the husband-wife relationship. Sometimes there is too much interference by extended family member. And when I say extended family member, I'm talking now about your mother and your father and your brother and your sister. No, because the primary relationship is your husband-wife relationship. And that's why the Bible says leave and cleave. And this is another part I touch in premarital counseling. Say, what does it mean to leave and cleave? And they say, oh, you know, the husband and wife, this is the primary relationship. And they give me all sorts of theoretical answers. And then I said, listen, some of them will hit it on the head. I said, this is a literal text. The same way I asked them to underline flesh. Because Genesis 2 is not a prophecy. So you interpret prophecy with symbols. Genesis 2 is not like Psalm, which is a poetry. Genesis 2 is literal. Literal 6 days and then rested on the seventh day. Literal evening and morning days. Literal fruits to eat for you and nuts. Literal one fleshness. And you underline that. I said, what does it mean? Leave, come out of their house. Literally. There are some people who can't do that because of finances. Well, somebody said, draw a curtain, get a room where you can lock away your things, and definitely cook your own pot. You're married to your husband, and you're married to your husband, and is your husband's mother still cooking? You're going to have a problem because you're not going to learn to cook. Maybe you can't cook as the husband's mother, but if you were gone to your own home, you would learn to cook over time. Either you sink or swim. So leave your mother and your father. And many persons rejected that counsel, and they suffer the consequences. I've had persons who come back to me because they suffer the consequences when you reject that counsel. Listen, rent might be expensive. If you are going to get married, that's why you should have some preparation and financial preparation. And I'm not saying you need to live in a big house, in a 3-bedroom and 4-bedroom. In Portmore, they have what they call a studio apartment. If you can afford a studio, and even if it is on the family property, if you can get a room where you can lock off your things and you can cook your own pot until you can find your own property. Listen, the Bible says you must leave. It helps to avoid the interference. So yes, you might enjoy the support of extended family member, but the interference could destroy your marriage, especially in the early phase. The first 2 years, try not to have any third party. Maybe later on you have to bring mama or papa to live with you because they might be ill and so on. In the first 2 years, try to have no third party. Leave your mother and father, because those 2 years are critical to build a foundation. You can't build a house without a foundation. You need time. When we're doing our expansion, the parish council says you must dig 3 feet deep and tie steel down there. And they said, we are going to send somebody to look at the steel to make sure that it is properly done. And then you can pour the concrete. And if you don't do it right, they're going to stop the project. Leave, severance, permanence, and acceptance. God hates divorce. Malachi 2 verse 16. The Bible says God does what? Hate divorce. And Numbers 30 verse 2 says we must keep, when we vow a vow, we must keep the marriage vow. Amen? So, Malachi chapter 2. And verse 16, last book of the Old Testament. What the Bible says here, Malachi chapter 2 and verse 16. The Bible says, for the Lord The God of Israel saith that he what? Hateth the putting away, for one covereth violence with his garment, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit, that ye deal not treacherously. God hates divorce. Bible says we must build on wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. You can read those texts when you go home. So how do we rebuild? Rebuilding the relationship. This is where we're tying it up this evening. So what we need, instead of going to divorce, we need to rebuild our relationship. Come with 1 John chapter 3, verses 10 to 18. 1 John chapter 3, verses 10 to 18. The Bible says we must rebuild on love. 1 John 3, verses 10 to 18. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that we have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. That we should do what? Love one another. Not as Cain, who was of the wicked one, and he slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous. Marvel not at this, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in what? In death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whosoever hath this world's good and seeth his brother have need and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. How should we love? In deed and in truth. One of the primary things that we need to do if we want to maintain our relationship is to truly love one another. Truly love one another. And so I tell every couple that we are preparing for marriage, that I'm preparing for marriage, that you must get into a competition of love. That Roy Dennis must say, I'm going to love Keisha so much that Keisha cannot outlove me. And Keisha must say, I'm going to love Roy so much that Roy cannot outlove me. So we are at the couple's retreat, and they ask, what would you do if you have one chair and both of you want to sit down? What would you do? And they were asking the couples. I'm glad they asked my wife. Because I was wondering, what would I do? Generally, the man would say, all right, let the lady sit down. But they say, both of you need to sit down. What would you do? And so my wife was the one who answered. She said, I would give my husband the chair and sit in his lap. And men love the, when their wives sit in their lap. Amen. So we need to get into a competition of love. The thing that we do in our marriages is that we are reserving and withholding love. So I've heard a woman say, I'm not going to love any man more than how I love myself. And the man say, I'm not going to love any woman more than how I love myself. So what we have is withholding and reserving love, and selfishness is the number one thing that destroys relationship. My car and my money and my house, and if he gives me 80% of love, I will give him 70. And if he gives me 50, I will give him 40. And the man is saying the same. If she gives me 50, I will give her 40. And there are people who are planning their way out, and they are not willing to give 100%. Marriage is not 50-50. Marriage is 100-100. I want 100% of love from my wife, and I'm determined to give her 100%. And I normally say that any woman Any woman who has a man who truly loves her and gives her 100% of love and she runs away, Pastor Shillingford, she deserved to run away. You want to write it down. If you get a quote out of this campaign from Pastor Dennis, then that is the one, right? You want it again. Any woman who has a man who gives her 100% of love and she runs away, she deserves to run away. Work it out. You're not getting it now, but when you go home, you work it out. That's all right. So let me tie it up. Let me tie it up. So some tips now. All right, after church, you work it out. Yes, it's all right. Just sit down after. So we have something more to say. We have something more to say. So if you don't get it, that one miss you. All right. After church, I'll tell you. After church, I'll tell you. Tips. So let me give you some tips now for building your marriage as we close. Let me give you some tips. Number one, take time every day to have a meaningful conversation with each other. What we recommend is pillow talk. Pillow talk. So you might have small talk where you just talk about things and run joke with one another. That's fine. But there's a place for a heart-to-heart connection with your spouse every day. Even if you're not at home, you must have a heart-to-heart connection. Talk about your love. Talk about your future. Talk about your finance. Talk about your communication. Talk about everything that matters in the marriage. It's called pillow talk. Compliment your spouse regularly. Amen. So the man said, he said, Pastor, you can't say that because your wife beautiful. What if my wife don't pretty like your wife? What if I don't think my wife look good? Well, is you made the choice, because remember now when we say making the right selection, we say you must choose somebody that look good to you. That's number one. But even if you wake up one day and she doesn't look as good as you would, you know, say that person look good. I said to him, if she no look good and she cook good, commend her for her cooking. So find something to compliment each other about. You know, and I said, my wife let me feel like I'm the biggest, strongest man on earth. Yeah, she said, my hunk of a man. When I look in the mirror, I don't see that. But since my wife said so often, I believe. Compliment each other. Forgive your spouse. Listen, Jesus was asked, how often should I forgive? Until 70 times 7? Until 70 times 7. In other words, as long as there's a need to forgive, you must forgive. Anything that is not forgiven in the marriage will be a mountain to destroy the relationship. And the person that you're going to need to forgive the most is the person that is nearest to you. So if you have your limit of 70 times 7 and you have your what you call it, your diary, and you're counting, and when you reach 70 times 7, you will say, I will not forgive him anymore. I will not forgive her anymore. That's not what Jesus intended. Communicate your feelings honestly. Make time to connect with your spouse in a loving way. Every day. Love your spouse in the way that they want to be loved. So, your husband loves ackee and saltfish, but you say that callaloo, steam callaloo, good for you. So you're not going to give him any ackee and saltfish. You are giving him steam callaloo. You don't give him no ackee and saltfish because you don't like it. So love the person in the way that they want to be loved. Find out what is your spouse's love language. My wife loves to talk about that, the love language. What is your wife's love language? They said you have gifts, you have words of appreciation, you have quality time, you have physical touch. What is, and gifts, what is your wife's love language? Do you know? That's something that you need to talk about tonight, because you see, people give things based on what their love language is. If you love quality time, that's what you're going to give. If you love food, that's what you're going to give. If you love gifts, that's what you're going to give. So you need to satisfy your spouse's need and love language. Take time to take care of your appearance. Take time to take care of your appearance. So, I've seen some ladies who are dating. Even now, you have some ladies when they're dating, they powder up their bosom when they're going out. Dress up and smell sweet and powder up their bosom. They are going out on a date. But after you're married, you don't remember where powder sell anymore. And you stop fixing up yourself. And if you're at home and your husband left, the same way he left you this morning is the same way he come back and see you. And you don't think that you should fix up yourself and look good. Men are attracted to what they see. And even if you are 75 and 85 and you're married, you must still fix up yourself. Yeah, I remember the lady in my home church. I can't forget this statement. She said, "You young ladies, you are dressing in some ways to entice your husband animalistic passion, and God is not pleased." And remembering that statement, I now say that, listen, you need to excite something. Because if you don't excite it, there are so many persons out there who are going to create some excitement. Men are attracted to what they see. And you're not in competition with somebody out there, but at least when he go home, he must see something good. Amen? Looking good. So the men are saying that the wife don't want to fix up themselves anymore. And I must say this before I leave that point. Listen, there are some people who think that a husband can lust after his wife. You don't lust after what you have. You lust after what you don't have. When you're married, the Bible says they were naked and not ashamed. Husband and wife. But the ladies are saying, men, while the men are saying the ladies not fixing up themselves, the ladies are saying that the men not grooming themselves properly sometimes. And not because you work and you're a mechanic and you work with grease, and you don't come and jump in the bed smelling like grease. The ladies are saying you must take a bath and freshen up yourself. Trim up your hair and purchase a new suit or whatever you wear from time to time. How do you rebuild? Remain faithful to one another. The man might be out there and he's tempted and he say, "My wife not going to know." The devil tells him it's just 5 minutes. But the same devil who is telling the man just 5 minutes is the same devil who has somebody with a camera setting up to catch him within the 5 minutes to destroy his marriage. And the same way the devil tempts you, don't you think that the devil is tempting your wife? Some of you men don't think that other men want your wife. You stay there. So every time you are tempted to be unfaithful, you must remember the same thing you can give your wife is the same thing she can give you too. They sell it at Easter. Sister Brown missed that one. Remain faithful to one another. And do things together. Husband and wife should do things together. Be friends with one another. Remember, we said it's friendship. Friendship dating, courtship. Friendship dating, courtship engagement. Friendship dating, courtship engagement marriage. You must never drop off the friendship. Husband and wife must be able to sit down and laugh and talk. You can't be so busy working money. You can't be so serious about parenting the children. You can't be so serious about managing the home that you can't sit together and just have a light moment. and cheer and home and family responsibilities. You are never too old, as I close, to say, to hold hands together. You are never too old to play together. One preacher says he loves to play with his wife, especially when they are playing hide and seek. He loves to play hide and seek with the wife. When he is doing the seeking and the wife, sorry, when he's doing the hiding and the wife is doing the seeking. Must play together. Never go to bed angry with one another. Do not take each other for granted. There must be words of appreciation and gratitude. Forgiveness must be extended. Flexibility and patience. It is, some of you are so rigid. My way or the highway. Prayer must be offered on each other's behalf. Hearts must be at peace with one another. And love must reign in your home. Too many of our homes, we're going to talk about that on Sunday night, is a war zone. God wants peace to reign in our homes. May God help us to commit to these principles as we seek to rebuild our relationship, knowing that it is better to rebuild and to strengthen our marriage than to allow it to fall into divorce. I'm going to ask Nikayla to come at this time.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? I want to introduce to you, here in this corner of the good and the right, stands a champion robed in white. His heart exceeds the heavens, his word outweighs the world, his reach reaches everywhere, his age is evermore. He is higher than the highest, greater than the great, no one could ever take his crown away. He's more than the mightiest, he reigns from above. He's the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion of love. He left his hometown to enter this arena, to raise his hand in victory over me. Oh, but the angry crowd, they crucified the king who wore the crown, and they gladly watched the champion go down. Oh, but I will never count him out, for I'm a witness of the day he rose to reclaim his title, champion of love. He is higher than the highest, greater than the great, no one could ever take his crown away. He's more mighty than the mightiest, he reigns from above. He's higher than the highest,
need is love in our hearts and love in our home. And that love we can find in Jesus. What do you say? Let us restore and strengthen our relationship rather than seeking divorce. I'm going to invite you to stand as we pray to close. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word again. We recognize the challenge that divorce has placed on our society and on our church. And it is a matter that we have to deal with, that we have to minister to persons who have gone through so much grief and trauma as a result of divorce. Tonight, Lord, for those who are married, we are saying that there is a better way, that we should implement all the necessary strategies and make all the necessary investment, that marriage does not happen by chance. It's an investment of both persons. So we pray that if there is one tonight who was contemplating divorce, either here in the congregation or online, that they will give this matter a second look. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that if there is anything that can be done on their part to resolve whatever challenges, to fix the marriage, to strengthen the relationship, that they will be willing to do so. God, we pray that you will bless the families represented here tonight and those online. Keep us from the willy traps of the enemy. Put the enemy to shame. Let the world know that God is still in the business of keeping marriages and families together. Right now, there are persons who are hurting, children who are hurting, persons who were married who are hurting because of challenges that come as a result of divorce. Oh God, we pray that you will be with each one. And we pray that you will bless the church as we seek to offer ministry and to reach out to those persons. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those who have not yet given their hearts to you right here in this congregation and those who are online. This coming Sabbath is our grand baptism. We recognize the importance of love in marriage, but we also recognize the importance of a relationship with Jesus. The best friend to have is Jesus. So tonight, we pray that it will be a night of decision for someone, that come this Sabbath, they will be a part of the number to be baptized. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Be with us as we travel home. And we look forward to a wonderful time when we will deal with the topic, House of Distress, this coming Sabbath. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good night, everyone. We'll see you on Sabbath. The subject is House of Distress. God bless you.
Amen. What a message on divorce-proofing your marriage. I'm sure that this message would have been beneficial to those who are married and those who plan on getting married. Once more, we invite you to join us this Sabbath at 9:15 a.m., whether it be here in the sanctuary at 13A Caledonia Road or online on our YouTube channel at the Mandeville Seventh-day Adventist Church. You can't afford to miss it. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. Have a blessed night and an even more blessed week. At this time, we invite our praise team to join us as we close with our theme song.
Years I spent in vanity.